All right, here we go, my friends.
Let's do this. This is José Trujillo, the world's greatest living artist. And let's start doing some good work, guys. Let's do this.
See if you guys can see this anyways. It's a little larger than usual. What's up, Vivek? How's it going, my friend? All right, let's do some work. Let's see what this looks like. It's a little hot. It's a little cold. I was gonna say hot. It's a little cold today. Very cool. Had a really productive day. I love that.
Yeah, that's the only way to have a day. Thank you.
I love that. I think the food is here. Oh no? Oh, I thought it was the food.
I haven't gotten a
little something like that. Do another one here with a little glass. There we go. That's what I'm talking about, baby. Check it out. Look at that. Oh, nice. Well, let's see if I can nail this, because I had an idea last night about this painting. This is what occurred to me last night. So we're gonna see where it goes. Do you want cutlery? Look at that. Here we go. So this is the idea, my friends.
There's mucho matcha right there already, baby.
If this doesn't prove that I'm the world's greatest living artist, I don't know what will. I'm trying to. Mmm, yum. One?
One?
Yeah. Thank you, Mika. Oh, thank you so much, Constance. Doing some flowers, baby. Man, you guys gotta see the front view of this. This is extraordinary. We're barely getting started. feel like, what's that dude's name? Fatin Latour, painting so many flowers. Thank you so much. I had a little daydream. It wasn't a dream, it was more like a daydream of this painting. It came in as an inspiration. I can recognize, I've been able to recognize now when something is an inspiration or something is just an idea. An inspiration comes very subtle. For me anyways, an idea comes with like excitement and hurry, 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 let's get it done. An inspiration comes slower. It's been slower. It's just like a slow cook, like cooking something slow. And so that's what I've experienced with. A lot slower. Okay, my sister wants to know if you picked up the brush when you were a kid or came later in the school. I picked up the brush when I was a kid. I was about 13 years old when I first started picking up brushes for acrylic and oil. I was a little younger when I started doing acrylic. But I wasn't, I just knew that that's what I had to do. It felt like this pool, very intense pool, I remember. Yeah, and it was a very, very intense pool. I couldn't ignore it. I tried to ignore it for a while, but it was too intense to ignore. It's almost like at some point in my high school years, it became almost like a screaming that I had to paint. It was so intense that it was almost like if it was screaming at me that I had to pick up the brush and paint. So that's when I started taking it a little bit more serious. Nothing too serious, but serious for. In comparison to my other classmates, I was already doing murals and very large work. I was studying frescoes. I was learning how to do frescoes and that type of stuff. Painting very fast. When you learn frescoes, you learn how to paint very, very quick. Because the plaster will dry on you if you're not quick enough. As I started picking up things like that.
But it didn't become more serious to me until I started doing it as a full-time job. This is one of the reasons I recommend artists to make it a full-time job, because if it's a full-time job, you have no option but to paint. If you don't paint, you don't get paid. You don't eat, you know. And so, this is why I push it. It goes against popular belief that you should never make it a job. You should always. But if you don't make it a job, you'll find a thousand reasons why you shouldn't paint. If you make it a job, it's not going to happen overnight. It might take you 5-10 years before you start getting a real hold out of your style. Maybe even sooner. Maybe I was just a slow burn. But it'll start showing up. Your style, your very own particular style, will start showing up on its own. It's not even something. It looks like somehow that you're cooking it, but you're not really. It's almost happening by itself. At some point, your hand starts knowing what to do. That type of deal. And so I think it's very important to listen to that. Listen to that call when it shows up in your life. Listen to it. I ignored it. A lot of artists ignore that call to be full time because they think about, well, how am I gonna pay bills, or how am I gonna do things, and that's certainly a challenge. So it's definitely a worry for many artists. I know it was a worry for me. But I found out that unless you figure out how to do it every day, you don't have to become a full-time artist to do it every day. But being a full-time artist pushes you to do it. You know, you run out of options. You can't tell yourself, well, today I don't feel like doing it. Well, guess what? You have to do it, because otherwise, how are things gonna, you know, how are you gonna keep the lights on your house? And so it pushes you to get out of your own way. That's the one benefit. The single most important benefit I find about being a full-time artist. Is that you're going to be pushed into action. Whether you want to or not, you're going to be pushed into action. It's the beauty of doing something. It's forced, right? Because you're gonna have to wake up and do it. It's forced, but at the same time, it's not. Something beautiful comes out of it. Or something, I don't know. That's just my own limited understanding of this whole thing. I
Painting large format also has its challenges because you have to attack it in a slightly different way, and yet still keep the quality.
And so you start finding the swing of things, you know, which is kind of deep. What's going on, good boy?
Let's see where we take this. So the trick to painting large, I found, is that you kind of have to approach it like
jump all around. But nothing gets neglected. Otherwise, you'll end up with just a big sketch, and that's fine, but that's not what I want. I want a painting, not just a sketch, not just a study. So nothing gets nothing's a stepping stone to something else. It's all important. Every brushstroke matters. Everything is important. And so you have to kind of move around because it's larger. But at the same time, you can't neglect it either. You have to come back to it. You have to constantly come back to whatever you started.
It's a build-up. The painting starts building itself. It doesn't need much of your intellect, because your intellect is already working very hard. So what's next is that you have to trust it.
Here we go, here we go. Something like that. Dude, I could be the next Hassan. Totally. Or Picasso. Yeah, I try not to get the colors to work together. I just paint, and somehow the colors just kind of do their thing. You know, the colors just start doing their own little dance. I just kind of try to paint. I'm like, okay, well, let's paint here. And it just seems like the colors start doing their own thing. One of the things that I talk frequently about is most of us don't brush enough. Most artists don't brush enough. And so you end up with a painting that could have been something else, but you didn't stay there long enough. You didn't brush enough. We get desperate. One of the biggest mistakes that happens in expressionism is that it gives you a sense that it's so fast and easy that you oversimplify it, and then you try to work really fast and easy on it. And so that's a mistake. Expressionism is any type of painting. You want to work at it with care. Whether it looks like a fast painting or a slow painting or whatever, you always want to work at it with care, and you always want to put as much work in there as possible, and not overcomplicate it, but also not oversimplify it to the point where you are not giving it the energy required for the painting to come out. So every painting requires a certain energy, a certain amount of energy. Large paintings are tend to be a bit more difficult because they require concentrated energy as well as
as energy that you have to spread out, but it also requires concentrated. And so it gets a little confusing sometimes into thinking that, oh, it's a large piece, so I can just kind of wing it. And of course, anyone who's ever painted enough knows that you have to approach a large one the same way that you approach a small one. A great example of that is the artist that I've talked to you guys about before. She does a great example of that, Erin Hansen. She knows how to approach a large one, and her small pieces, she approaches the same way as large ones. Large and small are approached the same way. The scale changes, but they're approached the same way. The same amount of attention. When you're doing wet on wet, when the painting starts feeling sticky, you're getting close to the end of your painting. It's a good indication. A very good indication. Erin Hansen is her name, yeah. Yeah, she pay attention to how she does a small and a large painting. When you get a chance, you'll notice she's mastered it too. Very few artists I talk about that are contemporary. Not because I don't want to talk about artists, but I find very few actually have it down. in expressionism or a form of impressionism. Very few artists actually have it down. She's one of them who has it down. And her stuff is mostly landscapes. Some still lives, but mostly landscapes. And that's the thing that larger paintings have. They have this illusion that you're going to paint them and it's going to be easier to paint. They have a bit of an illusion. If you want to do a good large painting, be careful not to fall in that illusion. It gives you the illusion that it's easier because it's larger. And so you can do less. What is it?
What does this say?
That says 17. 17?
Yeah.
Thank
you. Did you know?
Yeah, it's
17. Okay. Will you sign this 2017 for me?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, this is all just sketches. There's really nothing to unless I would I would orchestrate a photograph, right, to make it look like this. But this is all sketches. They end up just being sketches. You know, so like I say, it's a very very simple way of approaching it. But don't let the simplicity fool you either into thinking that you have to put less work. every piece requires is its pace. You're hungry, Rico?
Yes.
Yeah, I have some food right there, Rico. It's a feeling too, when people ask me when do you know when your painting is done, it's a feeling on the layers of the paint. There's a feeling that happens. There's a bit of a there's a hardening of the paint that also indicates me that the painting is about to be done or it's done. And I can tell where it's happening and where it's not. For example, this corner still hasn't been as worked as the rest of the painting. You probably haven't seen that. And so I'm not going to be completely finished unless this corner is also has enough love in there. The paint begins to cooperate with you when the painting is in its final stages. The paint begins to, at first the paint is kind of like going all over the place, and then it begins to cooperate. It almost feels like a very thick paste. There's there's a hardening that happens, and you start noticing it, and so that's where the painting is actually occurring, the art is actually occurring during this phase, that hardening. I don't think I've ever mentioned that before. But I mean, hell, why not? Let's talk about it. And of course, everybody has their own style, or will come up with their own style, their own way of doing it. But I'm just sharing how my way of doing it comes to surface. You start seeing things that weren't there before. And so you pick those up as you're going. Boom. Simple like that. Are you painting from your head? I love that. Yeah. Trying to do a little head painting. The only way to paint, even if you're using a reference, you should be painting from your head. This is really the only way of painting. Even if you're using a reference, you should not be using anything other than your head. Use a reference very little. A little percentage of the reference. The rest of it should be your head. I think that's it. I want to say that's it. Let's see what it looks like, my friends. This is an original Trujillo, kick-ass Trujillo. Oh, thank you. There it is. Give it a little bit of space. Should come together. I might just be a big old mess. Let me put it over a an easel, that way you guys can see it. I love that. I need that. It's available. As soon as I paint them, they become available. So let me show you what that looks like. God, I'm trying to move this stuff around so you guys can. My cleaning lady was moving this stuff around for me. I have two from eBay. Oh, very cool. Yeah, this is a 24 by 30 by. No, it's got to be more. No, I think it is a 24 by 30. I don't think it's larger. But that's that. That's the idea. Hopefully the whole thing comes together. Yeah. I think it works. It's the idea of having all this flowers on a table, tabletop, plates and whatnot. So there it is, my friends. Here's a signature. And we're gonna make it available somehow, somewhere. At some point. We're gonna have to make it available. All right, thank you so much for hanging out with me, my friends. What type of paint do I use? That's oil paint. It's the Winsor & Newton, the Winton brand. As you can see, it's highly pigmented. That's why I like using it. And the cost is not, you know, it's not an arm and a leg. So there it is, my friends. Thank you so much for hanging out with me. If you want this painting, go ahead and DM me before I set it up to auction. I might not even set it up to auction. Who knows? We'll see. All right. How long does it take to dry? About two, right now, 3 weeks. Right now, at least 3 weeks it takes to dry. It's because of the cold weather. It just takes a while. But that's that. All right. Take care, my friends. I'll talk to you guys soon.